son, the Earl of Surrey, is wounded and captured. Richard is very close to killing him. When with a great war, Sir William Stanley's forces are unleashed into Richard's flanks, forcing the king and his troops into the march. Richard's horse trips and falls. It is stuck in the clinging mud of the march. Richard drags himself to his feet and continues to fight on foot. The Earl of Surrey there, the personal farewell. This man should join his feet, and his legs are prominent. He valiantly continues to hold the banner, despite his terrible wounds. Richard is caught by the horse by his men, so he might escape and try to prevail. But he refuses, and charges into the fifth press of his enemies, trying to live or die as a king of England. He is cut down by a Welsh pillman. His body is then hacked on the ground. So dies Richard III, ending his short reign and 331 years of Plantagenet rule in England. He is the last English king to be killed in battle. Although much of Richard's army leaves the field in good order after their leader's death, Norfolk's vanguard has been severely beaten. When the Duke of Norfolk was killed, his men faltered and ran. Their opponents in Oxford's vanguard, along with the cavalry under Savage and Power, pursued the fleeing Yorkists, cutting them down wherever they had passed them. The Spaniards' men also joined in the rout. Many men died trying to escape the carnage, including John the Archer. According to legend, after the battle, a Lancastrian knight called Sir Reginald Bray found Richard's crown, which had been knocked from the dead king's helmet, in a hawthorn bush, and took it to Lord Thomas Stanley. It is the morning of the 22nd of August, 1885. As the mist clears, two armies face each other. The Royal Army of King Richard III looks across at the small but solid army of Henry Tudor, Earl of Richmond. Henry has put most of his small force and all of his archers into his front line, under the experienced command of John Revere, the Earl of Oxford. Sir John Talbot leads a small force of cavalry on the right flank, and Sir John Savage commands a similar mounted force on the left flank. Henry himself stands behind the army with a small group of bodyguards. The army stands with an area of boggy ground to their right, knowing that Richard's larger army would not be able to cross it in good order. Richard's army holds slightly higher ground. His front line contains around 2,000 men and is commanded by John Howard, Duke of Norfolk, and Robert Brackenbury, the Constable of the Tower of London. The king himself, with his personal army of around 800 mounted men, has stayed on still higher ground to watch the progress of the battle. The Earl of Northumberland's army is acting as the rear guard and will be called in to support the main army if required. Giving no clear commitment to either side, the large army of the Stanleys stands back from the field. They are showing no signs of movement, despite receiving repeated messages from both Richard and Henry, each urging them for support. Lord Thomas Stanley's son, Lord Strange, is being held by Richard as a hostage to make sure his father does not fight for Henry. But the younger Stanley, William, is free to join whichever side he wishes. With beating drums and the shouting of war cries, the battle starts. Henry's main army, under Oxford, skirts around the marsh, aiming to attack Norfolk's army. Richard orders his men to stay still until Oxford's men have passed the marsh. Once in range, the archers exchange deadly volleys of heavy iron-tipped arrows, and Richard's cannon blasts into the front ranks of Henry's army. The Duke of Norfolk's foot soldiers are then released, and they charge into Oxford's men. The onslaught is so strong then rearranges his men in a wedge formation to break Norfolk's line. This time, Norfolk's men are under pressure. Seeing his front line struggling, Richard orders the Earl of Northumberland's reserve troops to join the battle and reinforce the beleaguered Duke of Norfolk. But Northumberland does not move his army at all. Perhaps his advance is hampered by the marsh, or he may be wary of Stanley's larger army on the left flank. He may even have made a treacherous pact with Henry before the battle. The Stanleys still do not move. In frustration, Richard orders the immediate execution of Thomas Stanley's son. But the order is not carried out. With the two main forces locked in a desperate struggle, Richard's scouts notice Henry leaving the main army, accompanied by a small number of mounted knights and foot soldiers. Perhaps he is on his way to persuade personally Lord Stanley to join the battle on his side. Seeing an opportunity to finish the battle quickly, Richard and his own reserve of mounted men charge across the battlefield, directly towards Henry. Richard gets so close to Henry that he manages to kill his standard bearer, William Brandon, and also overthrows Sir John Cheney, a notably strong and capable knight. Henry's bodyguards then fight hard to keep their leader alive. Meanwhile, Oxford's men are pushing Norfolk's troops back, and the king himself is killed in the fighting. His son, the Earl of Surrey, is wounded and captured. Richard is very close to killing him, when with a great roar, Sir William Stanley's forces are unleashed into Richard's flanks, forcing the king and his troops into the marsh. Richard's horse trips and falls, getting stuck in the criminal mud of the marsh. Richard drags himself to his feet and continues to fight on foot. The Royal Standard Bearer and Sir Percival Thirlwall dismounts to join his king, but his legs are cut from under him. He valiantly continues to hold the battle, despite his terrible wounds. Richard is offered a horse by his companion so that he might escape and fight another day. But he refuses and charges into the thick press of his enemies, dying to live or die as a king of England. He is struck down by a Welsh billman. His body is then hacked on the ground. So dies Richard III, ending his short reign and 331 years of Plantagenet rule in England. He is the last English king to be killed in battle. Although much of Richard's army leaves the field in good order after their leader's death, Norfolk's vanguard has been severely beaten. When the Duke of Norfolk was killed, his men faltered and ran. Their opponents in Oxford's vanguard, along with the cavalry under Savage and Talbot, pursue the fleeing Yorkists, cutting them down wherever they catch up with them. The Stanley's men also join in the rout. Many men die trying to escape the carnage, including John the Archer. According to legend, after the battle, a Lancastrian knight called Sir Reginald Bray found Richard's crown, which had been knocked from the dead king's helmet, in a hollow bush, as to which to Lord Thomas Stanley.
Come on, I suppose.
we should do it. Do that.